Fire, the mystic. Fire, the thunderbird. Fire of Hephaestus and of Bast. Fire of many gods, partner to brimstone, byword of the devil. Fire, destructor of all things. Such was the ancients' understanding of fire. But today, we know all about fire. We realize that its effects are predictable, that it follows well-defined rules, and we put fire to work for us. Unlike the ancients, we understand fire. Or do we? Do we really appreciate that fires don't just happen, that they're caused by people? To understand the very nature of fire, it's useful to consider the process going on inside a single gas flame. It's a chemical reaction in which the fuel, coal gas, is combining with the oxygen in the air. Quite simply, the gas is burning. The same reaction is taking place inside this candle flame, although the fuel this time is paraffin wax. But like the gas flame, it burns in the oxygen of the air. Oxygen, which comprises one-fifth of the atmosphere. By cutting off the supply of air, the flame will die out when the oxygen in the jar is used up. At the same time, water is forced up into the jar to take the place of the oxygen consumed. So, besides a fuel, fire needs oxygen. But fuel and oxygen are not enough to start a fire. Fire also needs heat. Fuel, oxygen, and heat. The formula for all fire. The fuel in this fire is wood. At first sight, it appears that the wood itself is burning. But in fact, it's a flammable gaseous material which is given off by the wood as it becomes heated. Under controlled conditions, these gases can be obtained by heating wood shavings. The gases can then be ignited some distance away from the actual wood. The same principle applies to this wax taper. The heat of the flame vaporizes the wax, which in this form is then prepared to burn. This is true for coal and even for paper. In fact, every solid fuel must be heated to the point where it gives off a vapor before it can burn. When a sheet of paper is ignited, the gases burn immediately they have left the heated paper. So it appears that the paper itself is burning. Because combustion of this nature takes place so close to the fuel, the heat emitted causes more combustible vapors to be given off, which in turn generate more heat as they burn. The cycle continues until the fuel is completely consumed. This chain reaction is the basic principle of all fires. A solid piece of wood is difficult to ignite with a relatively small flame, because the amount of heat applied is insufficient to start the reaction immediately. On the other hand, a piece of wood splintered, like this, will ignite easily. One shaving will quickly be raised to ignition temperature and the chain reaction will start. Some solids can be so finely divided that they become suspended in the air as dust clouds. At a particular density, when each dust particle is surrounded by precisely the right amount of oxygen, even an apparently harmless substance like flour can be highly explosive. The consequences of this happening on a large scale can be devastating. Serious explosions have occurred in flour mills and other places where fine dusts are generated, including metalworking shops and coal mines. Air filtering equipment is extensively used to reduce this danger, but even so, every precaution has to be taken. Unlike solids, liquids are giving off vapor all the time. In the case of flammable liquids, like petrol, there's a certain temperature known as the flash point, above which there's sufficient vapor being given off to sustain a flame. The flash point of many liquids, including petrol, is well below normal atmospheric temperatures. So these liquids are continuously giving off vapors which can be ignited with the smallest spark, even on a cold day. Because of this, flammable liquids are particularly dangerous. But let's see what happens to petrol vapor when it's not burning. This shadow graph clearly shows that the vapor flows over the sides of the beaker, and as it's heavier than air, the vapor can collect in pockets without being detected. For this reason, a seemingly empty can may still be filled with vapor. This vapor is highly explosive. In this example, vapor from freely evaporating petrol is allowed to pour down a glass tube, where it provides an instant fuse for ignition back to the fuel source. Many adhesives and paints have flash points below room temperature and are highly flammable. Other typical examples are balsa wood cement, nail varnish and remover, and floor tile cement. Rooms in which they're used should be well ventilated to disperse the vapor. In draft-free conditions, a dense layer of vapor may build up at floor level. In effect, an invisible bomb. But even liquids with high flash points, like paraffin, can be very dangerous when the conditions are right. Since the oxygen of the air and fuel in one form or another are with us in abundance at all times, it's clearly heat that always starts a fire. Heat can be generated in several ways. Perhaps the earliest method to be discovered was friction. By rotating a wooden drill on a piece of wood, primitive man at last had a means of producing fire. So much heat can be generated by two surfaces rubbing together that today the phenomenon is even put to use in welding metal. Many conventional workshop processes, including cutting, turning and grinding, generate heat by friction. The sparks from this grinding wheel are actually metal fragments which have been raised to white heat by friction. So in any workshop where fast-moving machinery is used, there's a potential fire hazard. Bearings especially can become dry and overheated, and only careful maintenance can prevent the possibility of fire. Heat can also be generated by electricity. When a current is conducted through a wire of high resistance, a very thin wire, the wire gets hot. This property of electricity is put to work in many appliances which have been specially designed to utilize the heat generated in this way with complete safety. But if the heat generated is not allowed to disperse in the way intended, overheating will occur, and nearby flammable materials may well catch fire. The forgotten electric iron is a firm favorite for starting fires in this way. But less well known is the fact that if electric wiring is loaded above the maximum for which it was designed, it too may well become hot and may set fire to its insulation and to nearby flammable material. Already, this socket is overloaded and the wiring is heating up. When the wiring gets hot enough, there'll be trouble. So fires are always started by heat. Heat, which is also responsible for spreading fire, because heat can be transferred from one area to another. Heat travels in three ways: by convection, radiation, and conduction. To see how heat traveling in these three ways can cause the rapid spread of fire, let's assume that a cigarette end thrown inadvertently into a waste paper basket has started a small fire in a room. Unless the fire is quickly dealt with, radiation, conduction, but mainly convection, which is the most important factor in causing a fire to spread, will soon ensure that the house is completely ablaze. However, if the door of the room is kept closed, as it is now, the supply of air will be restricted and the fire will be contained within the room for much longer, allowing more time for escape and a better chance of saving the rest of the house. It's even possible that the fire will die out altogether. But if the door is opened, causing a sudden increase in the supply of air, the fire will leap back into life, and the heated air and products of combustion, which can weigh as little as 1/4 of the weight of ordinary air and can have a temperature of 1,000 degrees centigrade, will rise straight to the top of the house, passing their heat to nearby flammable materials. If the doors upstairs are open, the upper rooms will be immediately attacked and the whole building will probably be destroyed. Every year, fire exacts an appalling toll of death, injury and destruction. There is vast damage to property, hundreds lose their lives, thousands are injured. And yet the answer to this problem lies in the old maxim about prevention being better than cure. Properly secured paraffin heaters, for example. The correct use of electrical installations. Properly discarded cigarette ends. Carefully maintained machinery. Properly sealed cans. But above all, it must be remembered that although the chemical reaction called fire is started by fuel, oxygen, and heat, fires are usually caused by people.